I want to take this opportunity to say welcome once again to this new lesson of B4 Term 3, 2020, yes, 2021. Okay, it's P4, like I've told you, and it's Term 3. We are in the topic known as democracy, as you see on the board. Our topic is democracy. And the subtopic under democracy for now is games and sports. So whatever we discuss today will be connected to games and sports. Then, plus other grammar aspects, as you're going to say them. So, being P4, our vocabulary list is usually a bit shorter compared to P5, P6, and P7. The higher you go, the more words you add onto the vocabulary list. So, for us today, our words are already here on the board, not many. So let's go through and we see what the teacher has in his package for this lesson. Games and sports, the vocabulary is as follows: skip, race, win, lose, clap, defeat. One can read it as defeat, and that is a verb, or defeat. Then it becomes a noun. The pronunciation changes it from one part of speech to another. If you say defeat, a verb. Defeat with a rising intonation. Yes, with a rising intonation. It becomes a noun. Defeat. So you may read it as a verb, defeat, or noun, defeat. Throw, shout, games. Volleyball. Volleyball is supposed to be one word, so you're going to help me make corrections in that workbook. Yeah, the word volleyball was separated. You make it one. Volleyball. Then cheer, kick, first, show, and finally, according to our list, football, which is also supposed to be written as football. One word, yes. Volleyball, football, netball, basketball, all those words are written as one word. Okay, let's go through the list once more before we go to other stuff. Democracy is the topic, and the subtopic is games and sports. Skip, race, win, lose, clap, defeat or defeat, throw, shout, games, volleyball, cheer, kick, first, show, and football. We are telling you to read and understand the word meanings as shown in the workbook. On the chalkboard, the teacher has not explained the word meanings or the meanings of those words, not given. However, it doesn't mean that you don't need to master them. You need to master them. How? By reading what is given in that workbook. The workbook has details of the meaning of each word. I see game as a contest with rules to determine a winner. Yes, that is a game. Example, you need 5 players to play a basketball game. Okay, next is run. To move fast by using one's feet. Use your feet to move very fast. We say you are running. Run is among the best sports activities. That's an example of run in a sentence. Okay, next is lamp. Okay, to move quickly off the ground, forcing the body forward by leaps. That is jump. The word is supposed to be jump, but not lamp. So you change it from lamp to jump. Generous jumps over the face. Oh, sorry. It's a word supposed to be fence. Okay, other words are defined there, as you can see. Football, umpire, and ref, which is the short form of referee, then referee itself, plus coach, cheer, crowd, and others. However, if you have a dictionary, I recommend looking up meanings of these words further in your dictionary. Do not just read on what is in the workbook. You can say, let me take my time to look up the word coach in my dictionary. Because you have a dictionary, look up the meanings of different words you come across. You say a new word, you say, I must learn its meaning from my dictionary. And this is the opportunity you have to use that dictionary. Open it and look up words like umpire, words like referee, words like coach, and many others, as we have learned about those very words today. Then, after getting to understand the meanings of those different words, you are going to construct oral sentences. Oral has to do with using your mouth. You're going to use your mouth to construct sentences using each of the words shown above. It may be one of these words. It may be one of those new words you have in the workbook. So take time to read and understand the meanings first. Then you try constructing your personal sentence, not the sentence in the workbook, not the example given in the workbook, but use the meanings you have got from the workbook to construct your own sentence using any of these words. Word building. That's where we are. In word building, we want to look at how words can change from one form to another, maybe from one part of speech to another. And these are not parts of speech. We are going to be looking at verbs specifically, yes. When we are in another class, we normally talk about different parts of speech and the vocabulary, from noun to verb to adjective, sometimes to adverb. But according to our workbook, we are guided well, and they are telling us to change the different verbs to different forms. We have verb clap as our example number one. Teach, on which page are we? We are on page 28 right now. Page 28. But I need to write it here because we started from page 27. So you so far reached page 28. Yes, as you follow. Word building, in this case, we are looking at how to change verbs to different forms, the ing form and the past tense. Not past participle, but past tense. We see clap, clapping, that is the ing form, plus clapped. What's the spelling of clapped? Don't forget about double P. Clapped as the past tense of clap. Next, we see chip. This is another clap. It was supposed to be clap. Clap, clapping, and clapped. Okay. Kick, kicking, and lastly kicked. Kicking should be our answer. K-I-C-K-I-N-G. Small letters. I repeat, use small letters and do not use any full stop anywhere, because you are not writing people's names. You are not writing sentences. So no full stops. You are not writing people's names or proper nouns. So no capital letters. We proceed to lose. Losing should be our ing form. Lose. L-O-S-I-N-G. Losing with a single S, a single O. Then the past tense of losing is lost, as shown in that workbook. Throw has the past tense as throw, and the ing form is throwing. I hope you are following and writing the work as guided by the teacher. We have a dash, then winning with a double N, and lastly one as the past tense. Then the infinitive form is W-I-N, win. Next, run, dash, and rain as the past tense. So after that, we talk of running with a double N, because this verb is in the CVC category. Consonant, vowel, consonant, as you see in clap. Then consonant, vowel, consonant. You have to double the last consonant the way you did it here. As simple as that. But we don't have run. Instead, we have rain as the past tense. You may say, but teacher, here you have clapped, meaning here you are going to use run. Never. Run is an irregular verb. It can't have its past tense ending in ed. Next is support. Supporting. Support plus ing. That one I will not write. Listen and learn. Support. Supporting and supported. Correct. Jump, you write jump plus ing, simple. Then jumped as the past tense. Next is skip, is the infinitive given to us. The ing form is skipping because of the consonant k, vowel I, and consonant p. We double the last p in skip to form skipping. Next is, after skipping, we go to skipped. S-K-I-P-P-E-D. Done. S-K-I-P-P-E-D, that's skipped. Then watch, Watching and watched. This one is a very easy. Ref. Oh. Okay. This one is a bit different. Refereeing and refereed. Okay. Refereed should be R-E-F-E-R-E-E-D. R-E-E-D. That is refereed. Next is pass, which changes to passing, still double S-I-N-G, and lastly passed. Then you will do an activity after that word formation and transformation table or word building table. There's an activity on that very page 28, which is about the use of corrective forms of words given brackets to complete those sentences. How many questions are they? Only 10 questions. Yes. Answer those 10 questions. And after that, we'll proceed to adjectives on page, on the same page, in fact, 28. Adjectives. So we have an adjective. Let's take a look at adjectives, where we need the definition first. Which definition brings in a new word? Which new word will again define? What is an adjective? An adjective is a word that tells us more about a noun. We are saying an adjective is a word that tells us more about a noun. When you look at the word given in a booklet, we see the word describes, which is okay. To describe someone is to talk more about them. If they ask you to describe the teacher teaching you, you'll maybe describe me using the word black. Yes, I'm not a white man from abroad. I'm a black man from Uganda. Yes, so you say Teacher Manda is black. Some people use the word dark skinned. So the word black, the word dark skinned, those adjectives you have used to describe the teacher. Meaning, okay, they are describing the teacher. Therefore, the teacher is the noun you are describing. Or you are talking more about Teacher Manda. He's a black man or he's a dark skinned man. As some people avoid using the word black. They think it's offensive. Yet, I believe it is one of the words you can use to describe people. If we have whites, we also have blacks as well. So if you say Teacher Man is a black man, you have described him using the adjective black. Then the word man in that sentence is a noun. Let's go ahead and look at what a noun is. A noun is a name of anything. A noun is a name of anything. Think of anything you can see. Okay, look around your room and see. Or just inside that room. You can even check there is something inside your pocket. You can check there is something inside your mouth. If it is a tongue or teeth, all those are nouns. If it is a coin inside your pocket, that is a noun. If it is a money purse or a note, that is a noun. A note is a noun. Also, many things around us or many nouns are all over that place of yours. Similarly, where I am, I can see a lot of nouns. Yes, a booklet, a microphone, a camera, a bottle, a speaker, a bag, a desk, a wall. All those are nouns. So we are saying a noun is a name of anything. So if you want to describe that wall, that person near you, yes, that person is a noun, that microphone, that box of chalk, that pointer the teacher is using, you're going to use an adjective to talk more about that noun. So we are saying adjectives are words that are used to tell us more about nouns or to describe nouns, whereas a noun is a name of anything. I believe you've understood the meaning of adjective and the meaning of noun as well. Let's look at the examples of adjectives in sentences. When you look at the workbook, you already have examples of adjectives as stubborn, fat, weak, strong, high, and so on. Then you have examples of nouns. The teacher has just given 1,000 examples of nouns. Okay. Examples of nouns here we see boy, man, team, fighter, mountain. All those are examples of mountains. I mean examples of nouns. So let's look at examples of adjectives, but this time used in sentences. We have the ones in our book. Let's read. Jane is a sluggish netballer. Sluggish, the underlined word, is our adjective. Why? It was used to describe or to talk more about the noun, netballer. So we go. Most volleyballers were supposed to be one word. We say volleyball is one word, therefore volleyballers supposed to be one word. Most volleyballers are very tall. Indeed. If you want to play that game, you need to put on weight, not weight, height. You need to grow taller than your teacher to play volleyball perfectly. Okay. Most volleyballers are very tall. Tall is our adjective describing or talking more about volleyballers. So volleyballers is the noun in this case. Next is Jovan is a stubborn boy. Jovan is a stubborn boy. Yes, stubborn is our adjective as it is underlined here. And it gives more information about the noun boy. Let's look at the adjectives used on the board. And we see number one as Cheptegei is a fast runner. Yeah, that wonderful man in Uganda. Cheptegei is a fast runner. We have the word fast describing runner. You may say, she's describing Cheptegei. Yes, but the word runner refers to Cheptegei. Therefore, if I say runner is my noun, it's okay. You may say Cheptegei is my noun. It's the same because this runner talked about is Cheptegei. Okay, if we say Cheptegei is a fast runner, we are using fast to describe Cheptegei, the runner. Golola is a very strong boxer. Strong is my adjective. Then Joan is a sluggish netballer. I've talked about that as sluggish being our adjective. Exercise on page 29, where you are required to underline the adjective used with each of those sentences. Got those sentences? Read and understand. Let's read and understand first before we start underlining. You may find someone underlining the word light as the adjective in number 6. That is terrible. Identify the adjective, identify the noun it is describing, then you will be able to underline the right word. Some adjectives can come in this position before the noun. Others can come in any position, as you see in example 2 in your workbook. As you see in example 7 in your workbook, Mount Elgon is very high. High is our adjective. This time it has been used in end position. So that's all I can say about adjectives, and now they are used in sentences. But do that activity with great care. Just underlining, then the teacher will give you 10 ticks and excellent. Yes, good luck. Comparison of regular adjectives. On which page are we? We are on page 29, where we're going to learn about how you can compare regular adjectives. Regular adjectives. When we talk about regular adjectives, I mean, any comparison first. In comparison, we are referring to the 3 degrees we use for those adjectives. So we compare adjectives in 3 degrees. Which degrees are those? They are the ones you see on the board. They are the underlined 3 words under that letter A. The 3 degrees of comparison are the positive degree, the comparative degree, and lastly the superlative degree. Do people understand the spelling of the word degree? Maybe I put it only here. The positive degree, the comparative degree, and the superlative degree. When you talk about regular adjectives now, with the regular adjectives, most of the adjectives we talk about are given in the positive degree. That's why you see here, Cheptegei is a fast runner. Fast is an example of an adjective in the positive degree. Golola is a very strong boxer. Strong is one of the adjectives you can talk about in the positive degree. Still sluggish is in the positive degree. Now you can change it to the comparative degree. You can also change it further to the superlative. Yes, depending on the kind of sentence you want to construct or how you want to use it in the sentence. So, when you talk about regular adjectives, these ones, you think about letters ER for the comparative, then EST for the superlative. Those are the letters we think or we add to the positive degree to change it to comparative, that is ER, and superlative EST. Yes. Adjectives that have changed to comparative degree using ER, then superlative degree by adding EST to the comparative. Let me put this in brackets because sometimes it is not needed, sometimes it is needed. For EST in the superlative, all those adjectives are in the category known as the regular adjectives. So let's go ahead to look at the table as it is in our workbook and we see what to do. By adding R and ST, when we add R and when we add ST, we add R to the comparative, I mean to form the comparative. White is the comparative degree of white. If you want to change it to superlative, you are going to think of white. Plus, what do the instructions tell us? ST. Changing it to whitest. Meaning, our adjective white becomes whiter and whitest in the comparative and the superlative, respectively. My heading is a bit brief because I'm on the board here. For you, since everything is in the workbook, I just summarize what you have in the workbook and I write on the board. So we are saying by adding R to the positive degree to change it to comparative. Then ST to change the positive degree to superlative degree. Next, maybe before I go to blue, when we use R in the comparative and when we add ST in the superlative, we add these letters in these respective degrees. When the adjective given to you ends in letter E, there is a similarity in these adjectives you're dealing with. One, in fact, it is the only one. All of them end in letter E. Therefore, just add R to form the comparative, then ST to form the superlative. Done and dusted. I doubt whether you really have any question. Because when I go to blue, I'll just write blue like this, then I add blue. That's my answer. Next, comparative and superlative, that is blue plus ST, as the teacher has guided me. Simple as that. Everything here will be easy. Success as you complete the table in the workbook, because I believe the guidance you've had is enough. I don't feel good to give you everything, then when you come to school, we mark. What will I be marking? My work. That is very bad. Okay, let's look at the other table you have in the workbook, and that is adjectives that are changed comparative and superlative by adding ER and EST respectively. That means you add ER to form the comparative, then you add EST to form the superlative. So what do we have here? We have strong. You write strong as the teacher has directed you. Add ER from the word strong. Then strong. Add EST to form the superlative as strongest. Done and dusted. Next is quick. Quick you will do. Then poor. P-O-O-R. Add ER to form poor. Come here. Write poor. The same one, add EST, and you have formed the superlative for us, poorest. Finished. The rest we can fill in using what you have learned from this video you have worked for long. Next is by replacing the last Y, obviously, only the last Y should be replaced, with IER, and IEST. We can form the comparative by replacing the last Y with IER. We can also form the superlative of the same adjective by replacing the last word with IEST, meaning the last word is dropped. Drop the last word, place there IER. Finished. The word is shall be. Next, shall be S. S-H-A-W-B. Replace this last word with IEST, and the word is shabbiest. So I believe you are following this something very easy. Whoever has been following the lesson from hello to goodbye should be enjoying. Lazy. L-A-Z. Replace the last Y with I-E-R as guided by the teacher. You'll see how easy things are. Then I-E-S-T. So we said lazy, lazier, and laziest. Which one should I talk about here? The last one should be juicy. J-U-I-C. J-U-I-C. We replace the last Y with I-E-R. Finished. Then J-U-I-C. Replace the last Y with I-E-S-T. That's the end of our lesson. You have an activity that's on page 31 about, yes, on page 31. It also has only 10 numbers. You're going to fill in with the correct degree or the correct form of the word given in brackets. And that word in brackets is obviously an adjective. You're going to use it in the right degree. The examples are given here about how degrees are used in applied sentences. You can read and understand on page 30 before you try answering questions on page 31. It's the end of my lesson. Let's meet next time, maybe after like 7 days. Yeah, goodbye. Thanks for watching.